Welcome to Another Living Life. I remember a few years ago when I was a children's pastor, we used to have this program on Wednesday nights where we watch the kids and we have all of these fun events going on while their parents would go off to worship on Wednesday nights. And I remember there was this one certain child, he was in the third grade or so, and I could just picture him so vividly in my mind. And that day during free time, he was playing with blocks, these Lego blocks. And he spent like an hour on the project, which is like a ridiculously long time for one child to be focused on one thing. He was just working so hard, and he took all the blocks, all the Lego pieces that he had, and he built this just magnificent like structure. I couldn't tell what it was, but for him, it was so important, and he was just so proud of it. And after the hour, he came to me and he said, "Pastor Stephen, you have to see this thing that I built." And he took me over to it and he was showing off his work. He just looked so proud. And he had this like huge, huge, huge smile on his face. I was very goofy and cute at the same time. And I was smiling with him. And, you know, he was just showing me and he looked so happy and so proud in that moment. But then suddenly, as soon as he left that spot next to his project, his older brother came and smashed everything on purpose. He just like ran into it and just 1 hour's worth of work, like in 1 second, bam, everything was destroyed and everything came tumbling down. You know, thinking about that, I thought of two different things, two lessons that we could get from that. Number one, older brothers are the worst. I have an older brother, you guys probably have older brothers, you might be an older brother, older brothers are the worst. And secondly, no matter what you build up, no matter how much work you put into something, it could always come crashing down. And it doesn't matter how well you made it, any moment, it could come crashing down like those blocks we just talked about. As we ponder on these two truths, more about the second and less about the first, let's all come together and read today's passage.
Jeremiah chapter 51, verses 54 through 64. The sound of a cry comes from Babylon, the sound of great destruction from the land of the Babylonians. The Lord will destroy Babylon. He will silence her noisy din. Waves of enemies will rage like great waters. The roar of their voices will resound. A destroyer will come against Babylon. Her warriors will be captured and their bows will be broken. For the Lord is a God of retribution. He will repay in full. I will make her officials and wise men drunk, her governors, officers, and warriors as well. They will sleep forever and not awake, declares the King, whose name is the Lord Almighty. This is what the Lord Almighty says. Babylon's thick wall will be leveled and her high gates set on fire. The peoples exhaust themselves for nothing. The nation's labor is only fuel for the flames. This is the message Jeremiah the prophet gave to the staff officer Seraiah, son of Neriah, the son of Maaseiah, when he went to Babylon with Zedekiah, king of Judah, in the fourth year of his reign. Jeremiah had written on a scroll about all the disasters that would come upon Babylon, all that had been recorded concerning Babylon. He said to Seraiah, "When you get to Babylon, see that you read all these words aloud. Then say, 'Lord, you have said you will destroy this place, so that neither people nor animals will live in it. It will be desolate forever.' When you finish reading this scroll, tie a stone to it and throw it into the Euphrates. Then say, 'So will Babylon sink to rise no more because of the disaster I will bring on her, and her people will fall.'" The words of Jeremiah end here.
Today we'll be looking at the end of the chapter in Jeremiah chapter 51. You know, the first half of today's passage, we actually see what happens to Babylon. It says that the sound of a cry comes from Babylon, the sound of great destruction, that the Lord will destroy Babylon. He will silence her noisy din. It says these great destroyers come, just as God promised. And as powerful as Babylon was, as magnificent, as grand, and as large as it was, everything came tumbling down. That it was inevitable, that it doesn't matter how big and powerful you may be, that all of it could be lost in one moment's notice. You know, while reading today's passage, it reminded me of this great line from my favorite musical, Hamilton. This refrain from my favorite song. It says, "Oceans rise, empires fall. Oceans rise, empires fall. That no great power in this world can remain the power forever, that eventually all things will fall. And Babylon was no exception to that. Everything in this world, it doesn't matter what it is, no matter how major and grand and how populous the empire may be, eventually all nations fall. Except for one kingdom. Except for one kingdom. Except for one power, everything else in this world will eventually fall. You know, Jeremiah chapter 51 is often said to be the story of two separate cities. One is Babylon, like we read, and the other is Jerusalem. But it's not just Jerusalem and Israel that we're actually talking about, and it's not just this Babylon that, you know, lived and was there in the Middle East during that time that it's speaking of, that those things are actually representative of more major things, that it is the kingdom of God, and it is the city of this world that Jeremiah is actually speaking about. That Jerusalem represents the kingdom of God and Babylon represents the city of this world. And they're placed side by side here, showing us what happens, what will eventually happen to both of them. You know, one remains forever, one reigns forever. And though it may not appear so in those moments in history, it is always powerful, always vibrant, and always, always expanding. And the other always falls. And though it may not appear to be possible in that moment because of how grand it is, eventually any city of this world will fall. That ultimately there is going to be an end. And that is what God is showing us today. And that is actually God's promise coming alive. You know, God has talked about the destruction of Babylon for a very long time. But all throughout scripture, it talks about the destruction of this world. That if you belong to this world, that you will also fall with it. That this world will eventually go down, even though it may not seem as possible in this moment. That the kingdom of God will reign forever, but Babylon will always fall without a trace. And if we remain in this kingdom of God, we will not belong to this world. We will not belong to Babylon, but we will actually belong to Jesus Christ. That he is the one that freed us from the bondage of sin. He is the one that freed us from the oppression of Babylon and this world. And he is the one that invites us and brings us into his world, the kingdom of heaven. You know, Babylon is also the story of justice. You know, we often see terrible things happen to good people. You know, people we love, we see terrible things happen to them. It just seems so unfair. You know, people get sick. We lose our loved ones, we lose our jobs, and you know, we also see all of these amazing good things happen to terrible people. Whether it's the news or even in our own lives, we see terrible people, and for some reason, good things tend to happen to them. And we think that it's just so unfair. But Jeremiah 51, in today's passage, especially shows us that justice will prevail, that justice will flow like a river everywhere. And righteousness and justice will always be there at the end. And just as Babylon paid its price in full in today's passage, so will all who belong to Babylon and the world. That if you are without Jesus, then Babylon is going to be your fate no matter what. Unavoidable. You know, the chapter ends with these verses from verse 59 to 64. And it says that this is the message that Jeremiah had given to his staff officer, Zerahiah. And then that Zerahiah had presented this message to King Zedekiah, who was the king of Judah at the time. Afterwards, a very interesting thing happens. Zerahiah takes the message that came in a scroll. He ties a stone around it and he throws it into the river Euphrates. And there it starts to sink and sink and sink. And he says that this is actually a sign of what is going to happen to Babylon, that it will sink and never rise again. What does this mean for us? It means that God keeps his promises. Whatever God says, it will happen. Whatever he proclaims, it will happen no matter what. And nothing in this world, no Babylon or anything else in this world, can prevent God from fulfilling his promise. You know, God fulfilled his great promise to us through the person of Jesus Christ. He brought his son down here to be able to live for us, to die for us, raised from the dead for us, for our salvation. But God also has individual promises for each and every one of us as well. That my promise that he wants to fulfill may be a little bit different than the promise he wants to fulfill in your life. You know, he has a promise to save us, and that might be the same. But each and every one of us, we have a different calling and a different promise that is yet to come true. But know this, that if you place your trust in God, that if you continue to follow in his way and not in the way of Babylon, that every one of these promises will come true. That every one of these promises in our lives will come true. And we'll be able to join God and His total reign in the kingdom of heaven together with Him. Jeremiah was a servant of God. He was his prophet, the mouthpiece of God. But Jeremiah was also called the weeping prophet because of all the difficulties he endured as God's prophet. That it wasn't easy for him to do all the things that he had to do and say all the things that he had to say. You know, today's passage, Jeremiah chapter 51, it ends with these words. The words of Jeremiah end here. These were the last words of Jeremiah recorded in this book. But the amazing thing that we see throughout all of Jeremiah was that Jeremiah was faithful servant through all of it. That in the midst of all the suffering, persecution, and hatred that he received, that he never stopped being faithful to God and faithful to the call that God had given to him. That it didn't matter what came his way, that he wanted that promise that was promised to him to be fulfilled and come true in his life. And for that, he remained faithful. I pray that all of us today who are joining us in our worship in the presence of the Word of God, will remain just like Jeremiah, a faithful servant, not only today, but every day as well. Let us all pray. Lord, we thank you for giving us this powerful and mighty Word today. And we pray, Lord Father God, that your Word will convict our hearts. Lord, remind us of the promise that is fulfilled in us. Remind us of all the calling that you have given to each and every one of us. And help us, Lord, to remain your faithful servant through everything. Whether the good times or the bad, or the confusing times, or when we are prosperous, no matter what, help us to remain your faithful servant here for you. Lord, we thank you and we love you, and we pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen.